The NASCAR Busch Series rolls into Kansas with the two title hopefuls just 105 points apart as we get set to start the weekend with NASCAR Busch Series qualifying. Welcome to Kansas City as Speed Channel presents pole qualifying for the NASCAR Busch Series, making its fourth appearance at one of America's newest super speedway. Former series champ David Green, the Timberwolf Chevy, is the first car to test the clocks, chasing the track record of 30.27 set by Michael Waltrip a year ago.
Got a chance to talk to David last night. You know, he was a winner here at Kansas City a year ago, but it's the same chassis, but she's definitely got a different look this year. A year ago, he was racing Pontiacs. Now she's got a Monte Carlo body on it. And he was pretty good in practice, Larry. He was 8th quickest, so pretty happy with that car so far.
Yeah, they came out here and tested and felt awfully good about their test.
David's 5th in points after 27 races. Each of the top five about 100 points apart, except for a big gap, 2nd to 3rd.
His first lap was 30.95. Now, in practice earlier, he ran 30.70. This could be one of those racetracks. It's somewhat of a momentum racetrack, not near as much as Talladega, but we could see some of these cars run a little quicker on their second lap.
And, Larry, one of the things I found out talking to several drivers to see what David does do on his second lap, he actually slows down a little bit to about a 31.085, which is about 2/10 off of what he run for, almost 2/10 off of what he run the first lap. So it'd be real interesting right quick to see how things kind of work out.
Let me correct. The difference between first and second in the points, Marty Snyder, is 152.
Yes, indeed. And the man second in the championship standings is Kyle Busch. A busy day for Kyle. Cup and Busch Series racing today. So focus on Busch Series qualifying now. A fast race car you have, 3rd fastest in practice. Good enough to get the pole, maybe?
I hope so. You know, it's been a while since we had a pole. We have 4 this year, but it'd definitely be good to get another one. Wouldn't hurt. So the Shop Vac Low Chevrolet's pretty good today, and we're really excited. Hopefully we can qualify somewhere up front and just get a good, decent starting spot. That's what we need for this points race. But I wouldn't say we're the best car out there, but we're one of the best. So hopefully we can keep it that way.
He literally just ran here from cup practice, and we have some very fast cars. In fact, 2 of the 3 fastest cars in practice today go out very early. Should be interesting.
And cars, have we got cars? We have 54 of them going to take time for the 43-car field. Aaron Fike, who had 1 win last year in the Infiniti Pro Series, the 21-year-old from Galesburg, Illinois, trying to make what would be his 8th start of the season.
So the way I look at that, then you got to beat 15 guys to be safely in, right?
54 minus 38.
16 cars.
Meaning that 38 will time in. 16 will not. So the 5 provisionals will come from that 16, and that's how we do the math.
Yeah.
This is the Ollie's Bargain Outlet Pontiac.
His first lap was 31.54. He was 34th quickest in practice. That's exactly what he ran in practice, so he's backed his practice speed up. And he's quite a ways down the owner point standing, so this could be a car that really needs to get in those top 38. You'll see a lot of cars do what he did right there, run off the bank and try to get that run down the hill toward the start-finish line and actually get on the apron.
And since the whole front straightaway is curved, it's the short way home as well.
He picks it up.
Takes on that 3/10.
Yeah, good pickup. Bob Dillner.
Well, we saw Kyle Busch getting ready to go out on the racetrack, and I came by the 8 rig to find Martin Truex Jr., the Busch Series points leader. What was he doing? Sleeping, resting up a bit because you got a big lap coming up trying to go for another pole, and you were fastest in practice.
Yeah, just taking a little snooze, you know, get relaxed so I don't try to overdrive my car. But no, the best pro tracker boat show was great. Bono, the guys, brought a really good car for me, and put in qualified trim and really got it done. So look forward to it. Hopefully I can just back it up, and we should be fine.
Good luck a little bit later on. We'll be keeping an eye on the number 8 car out there. And boys, this guy tested out here just a few weeks ago.
A 152-point lead for Martin Truex. Wally Dahlenbeck ran here last year. He is in the Mr. Clean Auto Dry Car Wash 4.
This is a Team Renzi 2nd car, team car to Mike McLaughlin. Wally was actually 17th quickest in practice earlier.
Marty.
Yeah, Mike, I talked to Wally right before he went out, and he said, you know, we probably have a car that could qualify in the top 10, but really what we need to do is just get in the show. I know it will race well tomorrow, so I'm going to be a little conservative on this lap, so it may not be quite as fast as the car could go, but he definitely wants to get it in the field.
Yeah, he slows down, Marty, from what he ran in practice. He ran a 30.94 in practice. While his first lap is a 31.18. We'll see if, like Aaron Fike, he can actually pick it up in that second lap.
That Noah's right down against the racetrack. Car was out way close to the wall coming off the corner.
A little bit like Marty, I got a chance to talk to Wally earlier today, and he said the car really felt good. Again, talking about the tires, he really felt like the that new tires were not too bad on his race car. A little bit wobbly getting down in the corner, but he felt like they were going to come in pretty good on the second lap, but he slowed down on his second lap, so bit interested to see how Wally's going to turn out after that, because he did slow down from practice.
Just a bit, 14/100 slower. Hi, everybody. Mike Joy, Larry McReynolds, Jeff Hammond with you once again from the wheat fields of Kansas. It's amazing looking around this racetrack how, from what was just a field 5 years ago, shopping centers, hotels, all sorts of things have grown up around this speedway. It's a beautiful place to race at. Stories? Have we got stories?
Yes, we do.
We got one driver who can't get in his car. We've got 10 drivers in the top 11 spots in the points who have no idea what they're going to do next year, and we got a very, very fast racetrack. Where do we start?
Well, I think the biggest thing is these guys are on the home stretch now. They have 7 races to go. They have only raced once out of the last 3 weeks, but now they're on their stretch all the way to November. And when you look at the top 10, we talk about all the stories there, Mike. The biggest thing is 5 of those top 10 have not been to Victory Lane this year.
Kenny, with all everybody's preparing for this race, but there's a lot of movement in preparing for next season as well for these Busch Series drivers.
It really is, Mike, when you think about the fact we watched Kenny Wallace go around the racetrack in the Bill Davis Stacker 2 Chevrolet. There's a lot of teams right now that are trying to just get themselves on track, survive the next few races, get an idea what they can do for our sponsorships concerned. A lot of these drivers are kind of like looking up into the Nextel Cup Series already. Some of the guys at the very top of the list have already been quartered as far as moving up. Who's going to replace him? A lot of shuffling going along. And so today and the remainder of this season will be the beginning for a lot of these guys as far as the future for 2005 is concerned.
And not just drivers, but car owners as well. One announcement on Tuesday that we'll talk about a little later has a former Busch Series champion owner adding a Cup team, an Nextel Cup team, for 2005. So don't go away. You're going to miss something if you do. Kenny Wallace is second quickest. His second lap is just 2/100ths of a second off his first. So it's David Green, Kenny Wallace, Wally Dallenbach, and Aaron Fike.
That's pretty much exactly what Kenny ran in practice earlier as far as his time.
And Larry, we hadn't really talked a whole lot about it, but you know, Kenny Wallace being kind of like, almost like a hometown track for him, so he's got a lot of folks here cheering him on. But these Busch cars practiced a lot earlier this morning, so they haven't been back on the track since early this morning, so some of these times may be affected because of the weather. It is starting to warm up just a little bit, so the track may be slowing down just a touch as far as these cars are concerned.
Casey Kane is on a roll. Top nine finishes in his last 11 starts in the Great Clips number 38. Qualified outside pole last year's race, but got caught up in the wreck and ended up 30th.
The most amazing thing about this race team right here is we've had 27 races. He's only competed in 24 of those races, and he's ninth in the points. So that says a lot for their performance. But his qualifying has pretty much been phenomenal because he's qualified pretty much in the top 10, 18 times in those 24 races.
So when he's been there, he's been very, very good. But running a not a partial schedule, but a mostly, an almost all the time, other than conflicts, schedule.
And this team will run the entire schedule next year, except Casey's probably not going to run as many races. Tyler Walker, actually, that has been qualifying his car for him where they've been conflict events, will run the rest of the races.
And guys, when you look at this race car, you try to see what's on the front hood of that car. It has to be Shark Tales. A new movie just came out recently, and they're still got that on the car. And I think it kind of fits Casey Kane's personality, you know, part kid, part professional, but always out there and always hungry, trying to for the big win.
Now, he's on the pole that first lap at 30.74. He runs about the same speed. Now, I don't think he's going to be that happy with that time because he slowed down about 2.5 tenths from what he practiced.
Here's Bob.
Wally Dallenbach, just a little bit, I mean a little bit slower than where you practiced this morning. How come?
I don't know. It felt good all day. We, you know, the car felt really good, but it was just a little bit tighter there than we'd run in practice. And we actually put more tape on it and did some things to loosen it up. So I don't know if the track's just picking up a little grip because it's getting cooler or what, but that should put us safely in the show. I think we got a really good car.
Our producer, James Shifton, wanted to know why it took you so long to get out of the car.
Not going to have a very good show today, are you, with that producer there?
And hold on, Wally. One question from what we hear from the booth. Did NASCAR make you qualify and sticker tires? I don't know where that question's coming from.
What did he say?
Did NASCAR make you qualify on sticker tires?
Yeah, we did. Yeah, we did. We did make a mock-up qualifying run on sticker tires, and the car felt really good. Yeah, a little bit tight then. So we, like I said, we put tape on it and did some things to loosen it up, but we didn't loosen it up. But, you know, a lot of times the driver will drive in a little bit further and a little bit harder on qualifying, which will make the car tight too.
And that usually makes a crew chief a little bit ticked off, right, guys?
Yeah, I mean, I was actually asking that question because I think the NASCAR makes the Busch Series qualify on sticker tires, tires that have not been run. I think possibly a lot of these times that these guys ran earlier, right now Kyle Busch is second quickest with that first lap right there, is they're slowing down and maybe the cars are not gripping the racetrack quite as good on the newer tires, where their faster lap earlier was on tires that had been run one or two times.
Kyle Busch trying for his fifth pole of the season. He's got to pick it up about a tenth to displace Casey Kane.
Like Casey Kane, he slows down about 2.5 tenths from what he practiced.
So Casey Kane, who is trying to win his third pole in a row in the NASCAR Busch Series, his quickest so far. Eric Jones completes his run, the 27-year-old from Granger, Iowa, trying to make his first Busch start of the season. He had a top 10 in a Jay Prescott Racing Chevy Craftsman truck here at Kansas, and Eric's going to time in 31.83. Bob?
Casey Kane fastest so far, but a little bit slower than where you practiced this morning, Casey. No, you're not too happy about that, are you?
Well, this morning our fastest speed was on scuff tires. You can't scuff for qualifying, but we run a 60 on stickers, so that definitely won't hold up. It'll hopefully be a top 10, top 5 somewhere in there, but there's a few cars that'll beat that for sure.
Marty Schneider?
Ashton Lewis getting suited up here, and got some unfortunate news last week that your dad decided to close the family racing business. What happens from here for you, Ashton?
You know, we're not real sure. I'm out there trying to see if anybody's interested in me driving for them next year. That's what I'd love to do, is to find another opportunity to go drive for another race team. If that doesn't happen, you know, or if I don't think that I can get a ride that's going to allow me to win races or kind of improve on what we had here, then I'm going to use that engineering degree I have and see if I can't find a job with somebody as an engineer for a race team and kind of work my way up that way.
We'll let him go get ready for qualifying, focusing on this weekend's race. He said in race trim, the car is pretty good. They did finish sixth in this race with this car last year.
Now, Lewis said the team will complete the season. We'll have more on that when he makes his run. Clint Voschultz is from Woodland Park, Colorado. He's 33. He has 5 Busch Series starts, 3 this season. This will be his first try at Kansas. He also has 2 ARCA races here and a number of Pikes Peak Hill Climb Championships. He is a veteran of the NASCAR West Series.
Yeah, unfortunately, right now, he's the slowest of the 8 cars that has qualified, and this team has no provisionals, so I think that possibly is going to be one of our go-homers.
Coming up next, right here on Speed, Bud Pohl qualifying for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series. 4 o'clock, or whenever this is over, whichever comes latter of the two. You know what I mean. It's next. And that's when you'll hear all the Wizard of Oz jokes about Kansas.
Yeah, I think about 5 or 6 cars are sporting a Wizard of Oz paint scheme.
Imagine that. Wonder who Toto is. Can't tell you now. We'll tell you later. J.J. Yaley, the Home Depot Vigoro Chevrolet for Joe Gibbs Racing. Started 7th at Vegas, finished 8th at Nashville. His best of 22 events this season.
J.J. had a birthday Tuesday, a few days ago, turned 28 years old. He was actually 20th quickest in practice.
Larry, can you remember when you were 28 years old?
No, sir, I can't. I can't hardly remember when I was 38.
Glad so you brought that
I
up.
I bit right into your joke right there.
There you go.
31.05 for J.J.
That's fifth about what he ran in practice right there, Mike.
And again, you heard Casey Kane talking about the sticker tires, new tires versus scuff tires. Something that the Busch Series has done for a number of years is just to try to keep things equal as J.J. really gets up out of the groove down there in turn four. Car really goes up the racetrack. Just to kind of make sure everything's on an even keel and on the up and up, they just make all the teams qualify on sticker brand new tires, where in the Nextel Cup Series, you can actually go out and run your qualifying tires before qualifying.
Larry, if he could have kept it down just a little bit, J.J. picked up just a little bit, but he sure used a lot of racetrack up down there in three and four.
Marty.
You have to go far down the chart to find Matt Kenseth's name and ask you how the car was, and you said what?
It's terrible. It's awful. We've been struggling today. It's just been real slow and just can't get it to react to anything we do it. So hopefully they found a couple of things wrong with our Pennzoil car here, and hopefully we can get it running good and be qualified decent and figure it out in happy hour.
Slow speed-wise, but Jeff Hammond, I'd be willing to bet you they'll make this car work tomorrow afternoon. Matt always finds his way to the front, doesn't he?
He always does. These guys, it's one thing about Matt Kenseth. They have the ability to tune their car and get it ready to race when a lot of people can't.
Mike Wallace in the Geico Sport Clips Ford. Winner at Daytona, his 15th place start at Daytona in February, though, is his best of the season, and he's looking for his second top 20 start here in Kansas.
He was 26th quickest in practice, and Jeff, this is somewhat of a sister racetrack to Chicagoland, where these cars were back in July. As we know, Mike was leading that race when the white flag came out and ran out of fuel. So I know this is a different car. I talked to Tony Lambert, his crew chief, but you would expect if they had a good package there, they should run well here.
Yeah, a lot of times when you look at tendencies and a lot of guys that run good in Chicago, I had a lot of drivers also tell me, Larry, but they relate this racetrack a lot to Texas. Even going down into turn one and through one and two is a lot like Texas. So if you run good at these two tracks, obviously you would look and say, hey, you should run good at Kansas, and it should be a good racetrack for Mike. Depending on how he gets started, but he should be a good strong contender tomorrow.
Well, he'll be there, but 31.43 places him 8th of 10. 31.36 on the first lap. 8th of 10. Marty?
Mike, start number 350 for Jason Keller. Does that make you feel old? We're the same age, so don't say yes.
I've had a lot of races, and a lot of good races and some bad ones in there, too. But I've been very blessed in the Busch Series to be here as long as I've been. So, it's a milestone I'm very proud to accomplish, but I still feel like there's 350 more. So we got to get our act together and get in the right situation so I can do that.
He'd love to cap it off with a win. He's driving the same car he finished second with at Chicago just a few weeks ago.
Next, Marty, here's Paul Menard. In his seven races for this number 11 team, he has two top 15 starts and three top 15 finishes. First trip to Kansas for Paul.
This team is normally pretty fast in practice, and they were earlier today. He was 11th quickest. Remember, this is basically a Dale Earnhardt Incorporated package with that power plant under the hood as well.
He did finish 8th in the Craftsman Truck Series race here last year.
He goes to the pole, Mike. 30.67 for Paul.
Good lap.
And again, guys, we've talked about Paul several times, and Larry, you touched on it. They seem to be getting stronger, their communication. Notice that Steve Beal, the team manager, he was down there with his team today working with them. So I think as far as the communication with Paul and his whole group is starting to get better each week, and they seem like they come off the truck stronger and stronger every week.
And he's one of the few cars that actually picked up from what he practiced earlier.
Well, this should eclipse Menard's best Busch Series start, 8th at Talladega. Rookie Paul Menard is the fastest of 11 qualifiers thus far in Kansas. ARCA standout Brent Sherman from Barrington, Illinois, who finished second to Frank Kimmel in this year's ARCA points, trying to make his Busch Series debut. The Hickory Farms Certa Mattress number 58 Dodge. And that's going to be questionable at 31:46 for Brent Sherman, who will join the Aikens team for 20 races next year. Who's on track side tonight?
Oh, we got a pretty good lineup there, Mike. We got a man that started to get on the road here lately, Ricky Rudd. Clint Bowyer been sharing that Busch ride with Kevin Harvick, and the Nextel Cup points leader, Kurt Busch, to be with us.
That's big.
Big
and we
show.
May have some more surprises along the way.
And I don't know how we could have any bigger crowd than we had at Talladega last week.
Oh, my goodness. That's 7 o'clock Eastern time, trackside tonight. You heard from Ashton Lewis Jr. earlier. They have been racing well this season. Top 10 in points, actually 11th right now, but quite well for a team with blank hood and quarter panels. But Ashton's dad has said this will be the final season for this family-owned race team, that without major sponsorship, they simply cannot continue. So they're going to try to finish on a high note. Ashton, Charlie, the rest of the team members are among those who are looking for next year.
Yeah, and the thing is, when you talk about that, Mike, I read recently that Mr. Lewis has spent $2 million out of his own pocket to fund this team this year, you know, to fund the pickup sponsors they've been able to get from time to time. And it's a shame because they've been committed to the sport. Ashton Lewis is a very capable young driver, and he can get the job done. And if they can just get the kind of support they need, this team probably going to be contending for a championship. And they're 11th in the points, yep. Only 1 point out of 10th right now.
And the hope in racing, as it's always been, is bring the car to the racetrack, show results, and the sponsors will come. Well, sadly, the sport and the business of the sport have changed. Ashton Lewis is 7th quickest right now.
Welcome back to Kansas Speedway, where Paul Menard is on the provisional pole right now. You improved a lot over practice. That was a pretty darn good time, Paul.
Yeah, you know, I had my doubts in practice. We're coil binding one of our springs, and Tony and the guys, you know, fixed it, and pretty stout lap there. Hopefully it holds up, but there's some bullets coming behind us, so we'll see how it all plays out.
One of the big bullets you're going to have to dodge definitely is your teammate, Martin Truex Jr., and I know he's in the rig right now watching, so are you going to give him any hints or anything when you go back or on live TV right here?
I guess he just woke up, so Martin, you got one to beat there, bud. Russell's got the pressures, by the way. Let's see how it all holds out. You know, like I said, Martin's going to be pretty stout. Tony's going to be pretty stout, and see what happens.
If he's awake, boys.
And of course, the pressures that Paul's talking about is what air pressure they put in the tires to go out and qualify, and I'm sure Martin Truex Jr.'s group, Bono Mannion, that group, are interested to see what those pressures went out at and what they came in.
Sure.
Surely not, Larry.
Probably.
I mean, if you were the crew chief on that Martin Truex car, you'd be down there looking at their tire pressures. You'd be that calm.
Yes, I would.
You would.
I'd be wanting to know everything. How many RPMs you turn, the whole deal.
Yeah. How much tape? Yeah. Everything. So what do you think, Bob?
Well, you know, it's funny you guys mentioned that because as soon as he parked his car and climbed out of his car, Martin Truex Jr.'s boys were down here checking out air pressure, checking out every single thing that you guys mentioned. So that's why you guys are the crew chiefs. They were down here the moment he climbed out of that race car.
Well, of course, once your car is presented to inspection, it's on the line out there on pit road to qualify. The only things you can really change is the air pressure and possibly a little bit of tape on the nose.
Gus Wasson in the Race Girl Chevrolet, 3264. Let's see. They're in pretty decent shape for provisionals, and I'm afraid they may need one with that lap. Marty.
Front row, Joe Nemechek, 14th fastest in practice today. Kind of an early draw here. Is that maybe an advantage today, Joe?
Well, hey, you never know. If we go when the shade's out, I think it's going to be an advantage. This place is really, really fast today. You know, it's been raining for the last couple days. Stopped raining, track dried, extremely fast this morning. Both our Cellular One Chevy and our U.S. Army Chevy's running very, very fast. And I don't know, the time seemed like they slowed down a little bit from first practice this morning in the Busch cars. And got a little more time in my Cup car. It's extremely good, and hopefully I can carry over to this.
They tested at Charlotte on Monday in his Cup car, and Larry Mack, they tested 700 miles in one day. Took them 12 hours to do it. That doesn't sound like a fun test session to me, does it, do you?
Well, I'm sure, and I think most of that was tested at nighttime. Of course, the race at Lowe's Motor Speedway next week is under the lights on Saturday night, so trying to learn as much as they could for that night race.
And when your tests are limited, you got to make the most out of every day and stretch it out as long as you can.
You need to maximize it, and what a lot of these teams are doing nowadays, Mike, they're
going out there. They're running like semi-mock races, accumulating a lot of data with the computers, on board computers, and then going back and letting the engineers spend a lot of time downloading and analyzing it. So, you know, when you can get that much information in one day, that's really a good test.
Matt Kenseth, the Pennzoil Ford, 31.65 for the defending cup champ.
I don't think he'll be very happy with that. Let's see if he can pick it up on his second lap. He picks it up, not a lot of positions, but interesting enough, if there was a racetrack that I would like to see my Nextel Cup driver run the Busch Series race, it would be here, because this racetrack changes so much from the Busch race to the Cup race, and we only have two guys in the top 10 in Nextel Cup that's in this race, Matt Kenseth and Tony Stewart.
He's 11th out of 16, which is by no means safe, because they're not that high up on the provisional list.
Well, and just remember, he would not get provisional anyhow, because he's in the top 35 in Nextel Cup points.
So, like Larry's trying to point out right now, he's got to hold his breath. He can sit back here and sit down in here and kind of sweat bullets for a little while, Mike, to see how things work out. And right now on the track, young man I got a chance to spend a little time with last night, Travis Geisler, noticed after practice, he had a little bit of damage done to the right side of the car. Told me he got up a little bit too high into the corner going into one and got in that safer barrier. Didn't do a lot of damage, but did kind of make the car, as he said, a little uglier than what it was.
Comes out of the ASA and the NASCAR Southeast Series, which will have its banquet tomorrow night in Charlotte, North Carolina, from 2004 season.
Travis was 33rd quickest in practice. He's seeing Kansas Speedway, though, for the very first time, as he has a lot of these racetracks this year.
DCT on the hood, Dreams Come True Motorsports, name of that race team. And again, another of the teams that is trying to put together sponsorship.
Yeah, they'd like to run the whole schedule next year. I talked to Ricky Pearson, the crew chief, this morning. He said right now it's possibly going to be a partial schedule about what, like they've ran this year. But Ricky told me one thing about Travis. He said, you know, I've been so impressed how quick this man picks up on things. He said the first Richmond race back in May, we were five laps down. NASCAR even got on us about running too slow. This Richmond race, we finished on the lead lap. Said he really picks up on tracks as he goes to them a second time.
He picks up more than a tenth on his second lap, so Geisler right now is 12th. Marty?
Mike, the last time we saw Robbie Gordon in a Busch Series car, he was in victory lane at Richmond. Is the car good enough today to not put you in victory lane, but maybe give you the pole?
I don't know. You know, we were right next to Paul Menard there in practice. I think he was 10th and we were 11th. So if we made the right adjustments on the Fruit of Loom Chevrolet, we got a shot at it. But this is the same car we ran at Richmond, and I think it's going to be good here. It's been good at all the mile and a half racetracks, and I think we'll be really good here as well.
One point to take into consideration, you crew chief guys, the sun is starting to come out, warming up a little bit out here.
Yeah, that'll be good news for the guys that's already qualified, and bad news for the ones that's on deck, you might say. This racetrack will definitely slow down and get very hard to get a hold of if the sun comes out.
Jason Keller in the Miller High Life Light, number 22 for PPC Racing. Team owner Greg Pollux on Tuesday announced that they are adding a Nextel Cup team, not just for 2005, but they're going to start next week at Charlotte and run right on through 2004. Victory Brands, A-Plus, and Sunoco will sponsor the number 14 with John Andretti, the driver.
I'm really happy for John Andretti. He's really hung in there all year long, you know, a limited schedule with DEI, and I know that his heart has been definitely this racetrack every weekend, wanting to get back into competition, but he had to find the right situation, and it looks like he's got a good one.
And PPC hoping to continue in the Busch Series and the Truck Series for 2005. But again, like most teams, pending the signing of a major sponsor.
Yeah, Jason's definitely one of those drivers that everything is not set as far as 2005. And his first lap is 31.36. He was 16th quickest earlier in practice, and he pretty much runs identical time. So Jason's actually slowed down about 0.4 from practice.
And that'll be a disappointment, because he's qualified fifth in two of the three races we've had here at Kansas.
And he has two top five finishes here as well.
We talked on camera about the tornado that surrounds a double zero car. Let's go downstairs and get that story.
Well, Jason Loeffler not in the car here at Kansas, and this guy is Blake Feast. And Blake, you're running the double O, top five in practice, but you didn't know you're going to be running that on Monday, did you?
No, I didn't. Just got a call this week asking if I drive it here, and of course I'd love to, so I'm glad I'm here. Thankful for the opportunity. Just happy to be here. You know, I hadn't planned. Talladega was the last planned race for me, so we were quick in practice. Booty and I are working good together, and everybody on the Haas Automation Chevrolet's really clicking. So I'm happy. I've never been that fast.
Of course, you won the ARCA race last weekend at Talladega, but you're still trying to figure this place out. In fact, you just asked me a question a little while ago that you want an answer to.
Yeah, I just wondered. I see those guys coming down on the apron right at the start-finish line, so I'm trying to figure out somebody with more knowledge than me, if that helps or if it's just monkey see, monkey do. So ask somebody with more knowledge.
We got a couple guys up in the booth, Jeff Hammond, Larry Mack. Can you answer that question for Blake?
Well, I think there's two reasons they do it. Again, you get that runoff of turn four, and you try to get the momentum coming down the hill toward the start-finish line like they do at Michigan. And like Mike Joy pointed out, this straightaway is a continuous curve. That shortens the distance up to the start-finish line.
Hey, bottom line is tell him to do it.
All about momentum, they said, just do it.
Just do it?
Just do it.
Just do it.
Okay, I will.
He's going to listen to you, boys.
All right.
Stanton Barrett in the Americans, number 91, 31.66, 15th fastest. And we'll have more on the double zero story for you a little later. This is Mark Green's new ride. Yes, that says lovefifi.com. Somehow I have a feeling that only Jeff Hammond can explain this.
Well, I had the privilege last night of introducing Mark and his new car owner and sponsor at an event I was at last night, and I got a chance to meet Fifi and was quite impressed with their thought process of realizing that 40% of our audience is female. And what this is, it's a lingerie that you can order online as well as for men and women. So neat concept, and the good thing about it is right now Mark Green has got some support. He's got an opportunity to race, and after that qualifying run, it looks like he's in pretty good shape as far as tomorrow's concerned.
Yeah, it's a good run for Mark. He's 10th quickest. Our cameraman up here in the booth, Bill Stafford, gives thumbs up to the website, lovefifi.com.
And they're going to run the full schedule next year.
Come on, guys. Turn the computer off. Joe Nemechek's on the track in the Cellular One Chevy.
Go front
first
row,
lap,
Joe.
31:15. That is eighth fastest. Got a little ways to go. That lacks about half a second of being the pole man.
Yeah, and the weather right now, you know, he kept talking about it, and we've kind of pointed it out. It's definitely a lot more sunshine on that racetrack than we've seen so far since the start of practice, start of qualifying.
We've been talking about the milestones. Tomorrow will be Joe's 250th career first series start.
Second lap lacks a tenth of the first. So Joe right now is eighth of 21 drivers to qualify so far. Paul Menard, a rookie, is fastest in Kansas so far. Bill Eversole from Chelsea, Michigan, the 03 ARCA Rookie of the Year, finished seventh in the standings. One top 10 and three ARCA starts this year. And he times in at 32.64. Eversole's car, the Hardcore Motorsports Chevrolet. Sounds like a good time to tell you about Auto Erotica on speed. The Goodwood Festival of Speed.
Mike, I was telling you a minute ago, been there over in England. It is an awesome festival. I guarantee you, you get a chance to see more of the most historic cars from around the world than I've ever seen in one place.
You went there with DW, didn't you?
Went there with DW Junior Johnson. Yep. So it was a great opportunity for me to visit this Festival of Speed, so get a chance to check it out.
Wednesday 9 p.m. I think Rolls-Royce is the featured mark for this year.
That's what I love about it. Each year it's a different manufacturer. They get a chance to bring out all of their old historical cars and put them on display at this old castle. It's a great city.
Stacy Compton started seventh and fifth in his two Busch Series appearances here, and started fourth in his World Cup race. So we'll see what he can do with the Kingsford Ford. First lap 31:35, second fastest of the Fords, but 12th overall.
Just a little bit quicker than what he practiced at, Larry.
Yeah, he was 29th quickest in practice. Had a good run in the race here last year, finished eighth. And this is one of the teams that pretty much everything is signed, sealed, delivered for next year. Stacy Compton, plus their sponsor, Kingsford. If Stacy can pick it up on his second lap, picks it up just a little bit, so he's 12th quickest.
Quickest forward is Wally Dahlenbeck, who is ninth. So Stacy hangs at 12th place. Marty.
Well, Mike, let's introduce everyone to Brandon Miller, young 23-year-old driver, the newest of the Richard Childress Racing young guys to come about. How did this come about that you got in this car, Brandon?
Yeah, actually, I think what kind of helped to open the doors is I practiced and qualified Robbie Gordon's Busch car a couple times, and I got a call from all the people at RCR and went down to a test, and everything went well, and we're here today, and hopefully we can come home with a good finish.
And he said, I just want to get it in the show. He's going to run this week and next week in Charlotte. Promising young driver from California.
But Marty, I also heard where Bobby Hutchins, who's RCR's vice president of competition about 2 years ago, saw this young man when he drove a truck for Kevin Harvick at Bakersfield and qualified sixth and finished eighth. I think that's where they actually first discovered him.
And go a little further back than that. Got a chance to talk to Richard Childress, the owner, and he said that where he really picked up on it was Kevin used to race against him in the kart series before he went over to Europe and raced shifter karts and stuff in Europe for a while. So when he came back in here and they got a chance to see him out there in California race one more time, they definitely knew they wanted to take a look at this young man. And so far, they've been very impressed with him.
Robert Presley in the Clorox Thriftway, number 47 Ford, 31-36. That is just 4/100ths off what his teammate Stacy Compton just ran. This is Robert's first trip to Kansas in a Busch car. He has one cup race here and two Craftsman Truck Series races at this track.
Of course, this is Stacy Compton's teammate, and just like Stacy Compton, Robert Presley, Clorox, they are also signed for next year. So that has to make Tad Geschechter pretty happy that both of his teams, both of his sponsors, is signed for 2005.
And they qualify right next to each other, 12th and 13th thus far.
And it's really, Mike, if you know, if you've got team cars and you're really kind of working together and both drivers are capable, which both Stacy and Robert are, they should qualify very close to one another. And I think it's good to see that the team are able to communicate and both the cars are running that well.
Robbie Gordon, the Fruit of the Loom Chevrolet. Last time we saw Robbie in a Busch race looked a lot like this.
It was so good to see this race team right here get the victory lane with Robbie. This team started late in the winter, didn't get to do any testing, and they came so close so many times to winning a race earlier in the year.
So now Robbie comes out to take time in his second Busch Series race at Kansas. He started third here in 2001.
You heard him say this is the same car he won Richmond with. I talked to his guys early this morning. This is the same car they've just about raced in every race other than the Super Speedways.
Larry, we really hadn't talked very much about it during this qualifying session, but a lot of the drivers I talked to said how important it was to try to get a good qualifying spot, because this racetrack, as fast as it is, it's still pretty much a one-groove racetrack, very difficult to pass. So the further up you can be, the better off you're going to be. And after his first lap, Robbie Gordon is 19th.
Yeah, I know coming here for the fourth year, the hopes are, like a lot of other racetracks we go to, that we will get a second groove race. And, of course, on qualifying, you see, just like Robbie Gordon, they're right around the bottom of the racetrack. But there's no question everybody wants to get that track position in the beginning, because this track has 14 degrees of banking. But basically, when you're out there on the racetrack, it's like a flat track. It does not seem to have a lot of banking.
Third place, 30.739. Now talk about pickup. That is 0.8 seconds.
Figured something out to do or not to do on that first lap.
Wow.
For that second.
I don't think he liked them new tires.
Because they're scuffed on the second lap.
Sure are.
Started third at Richmond, and right now he is third at Kansas City. Back to Kansas, where we are halfway in Busch Pole qualifying. Derek Cope, the Advil Liquigels board, our next qualifier, making his first Busch race at Kansas. He has two cup starts here. The 24, Steve Grissom, the GIC Mixa Motorsports Chevy, will not make a qualifying run. They were excused from their go time, and they have said they will not present the car for qualifying. They may be high enough up on the provisional list to get a start.
Derek was 37th quickest in practice earlier, 31.62. So he does on his first lap here, 31.99. So he has slowed down almost 0.4 from practice, as we have seen a lot of cars do.
Like I say, Jeff, for the first time today, we've had sun on the racetrack for a fair amount of time now.
The other thing I'm noticing right now on Derek's car, he is already pushing water out the overflow, which is on the hoses on the right side of the car. It's like steaming coming off of turn two. So he's already running a little bit hot. Could affect his horsepower down the back straightaway and may eventually slow down a little bit in the second lap.
I did notice a little opening in the grill there at the very bottom of the top opening, and he slows down quite a bit on lap two. And it's almost like when these engines get over about 235, 240, they actually start to lose power.
Marty?
I've tracked down hometown boy Clint Boyer here, the Kansas native, from about an hour and a half from, well, away from here, Emporia, Kansas. Now, you have the most unusual good luck charm for qualifying I've ever seen in my life. Now, what is this?
Well, it's my license to drive, I guess. It's an Elvis driver's license. It's a crew member at old Hacksaw here.
Hey, let's hold it up there.
Yeah, we can hold it up. A little Elvis action. We're all Elvis fans. We went to Graceland a couple weeks ago and had a good time at Memphis and had a good test there. So we got to visit the King and all that kind of stuff. So always keep that for good luck for qualifying.
Never heard of an Elvis license. Good luck for qualifying. But if it works, why not? Bob?
Well, Marty, Robbie Gordon's got a little secret weapon because, man, you picked up from that first lap to that second lap something like 8/10 of a second. Where'd that come from?
We thought that we might be a little bit better on our second lap on tires, so we just conserved it at the first lap and stuck a time up there on the second one. Missed it by a little bit of a 10th of a second. It felt so good coming to the green the first lap. I tried to run 3 and 4 flat out, just got a little bit tight. Had to check up.
Robbie Gordon with a pretty good time, and you know, Larry Mack and Jeff Hammond, might he have been maybe scuffing in those tires a little bit for that second lap?
Well, we definitely saw that he picked up a bunch, but I'm going to tell you who picked up a bunch on his first lap is this Brandon Miller in this RCR car. He is 8th quickest on his first lap at a 31.08.
And Larry's down there talking to Danny Lawrence, head engine builders for RCR, about this young man. And today was the first time he'd ever seen this racetrack and went out and put down some pretty impressive practice lap times. So he is definitely a rare find, and he's going to look like he's going to hold right there at 8th place. Picks up just a little bit on the second lap, but not enough to move him up as far as the position and on the starting grid so far.
Casey Mears is going to get ready in the car, and he's not walking away from us. Here he is. So how's the car? 5th fastest in practice. Pretty good.
Yeah, I felt really good in practice. Really well balanced. You know, I need a little bit more overall grip. Looks like the track has lost some grip, you know, so hopefully we can just go in there and put a good lap in, do the best we can for Yellow Transportation and for Finch, and we'll see how good we can do.
I don't think it's going to work if your partner rides with you today, though.
Yeah, we got the Yes We Can man with us, so Yes We Can sit on the pole. We're going to try to do it.
Yes, they can sit on the pole.
Mike McLaughlin in the Renzi number 25, the Team Marines Ford, which he will drive the rest of the season. He has 2 starts here at Kansas, looking for his first top 20 start. This team did qualify 11th here in 2002.
What a great run, though, he had a couple of weeks ago at Dover. Finished 2nd. Great run. Mike had a birthday a couple of days ago, turned 48 years old on Wednesday.
Did he's that old?
Gordon Slob's book, he is.
Gosh, if he's 48, I'm really feeling old. He's still a kid that drives the Z8 potato wagon on the dirt circuit to me.
Look, you guys get it all wrong. He's 48 years young.
Better yet.
He can still mash that gas.
He still mashed the gas. He and Harold Holly, you know, had an opportunity one time to almost work together. Didn't quite materialize, but since they've gotten back together, they have definitely look strong in this Team Marines car.
Mention that, and from that Angela Motorsports debacle, as Mike McLaughlin is 7th fastest, the good news was that the finance guy who did all of that flim-flamming and embezzling got sentenced 2 weeks ago to several years in the slammer, and the judge said, I wish I could put you away longer. So sad that's the only good news that's come out of that. But
that's true.
The other good news is that Mike McLaughlin now has a full-time Busch ride, and he is showing his strength.
He is on the mark every week right now.
Well, I guess McLaughlin must be 48 because his old adversary and running mate Jeff Fuller is 47. Two guys used to race in the mod squad and both run national championships there. But he's in the show comfortably, 19th. 31.41 is his time for Sonny Macheka in the 88. He'll be his 160th Busch Series start.
And that's good news for three guys that were go or go home, Wally Dahlenbach, Aaron Fike, and Mark Green, who really didn't have a lot of provisions for any. Those guys are locked in this field.
Whoa, hang on there, Buddy Rowe. Pat Boyer's car, I mean, did a little D-I-Do right in the middle of one and two. The back end tried to kick out, and he did a good job of hanging on to it, guys.
He was seventh quickest in practice, and you heard when they interviewed him, this is pretty much his home track. He's from about an hour away in Emporia, Kansas.
Well, he's got a strong following around here, and I'm sure he's trying to get all he can out of this Reese's Chevrolet right now as he goes around the racetrack. But definitely that first lap, she was doing a lot of wiggling getting down into one and two.
Pretty much backs it up. He's only 23rd quickest, so we hope now he'll learn what happened that first lap and he can pick up on the second lap.
He won championships locally at Lakeside and Harton Park Speedways in the modified division and was the runner-up for the NASCAR Weekly Racing Series by Dodge National Championship in 2002.
He's going to be in this car quite a bit the rest of the year. He's going to run Memphis. You heard him talk about testing there. He's going to run Atlanta as well as Homestead. And he picks it up quite a bit, about 0.4 on that second lap, so he's now 14th quickest.
31-27. Here's Marty.
Mike, Greg Biffle just telling me that he can't get the Busch Series car to go, but the Cup car is pretty quick. Can you learn anything over there that can help this car run better?
Well, not really. You know, our aero package is pretty different on the Cup cars. That's the car I won at Michigan with. It's a really good car. I'm excited for Sunday. This is my favorite Busch car, though, Chassis 80. I've won both California races with it. Run good at Chicago with it, but can't get it to go here at Kansas. I don't know why, but we'll get her going at happy hour for sure. But just hopefully I can qualify in the top 20. I don't think I'm going to be real good at qualifying, but we'll see how it works out.
Yeah, guys, right now the fastest Ford is only 12.
Well, right now, actually, that was Wally Dahlenbach. Now the fastest Ford is Mike McLaughlin, who is seventh quickest. Casey Mears, the yellow transportation Dodge, in two Kansas starts, 13th and 6th with the green flag.
Car has a little different look to it this week. Maybe it don't show up right here. I know as I was in the garage area this morning, it's a much brighter orange, and I think this is the paint scheme they're thinking about running next year. Of course, their headquarters is right here in Kansas, Yellow Transportation. He's 16th quickest on his first lap at 31-32.
What was the name of that color originally? It was Swamp Hollow Yellow or something. There's a big story about when this trucking company was started. The founder said, I want all our trucks to be easy to spot so they, you know, don't get in accidents. Want everybody to see them coming. And the brightest color they could find was much like this.
And I would say that's true because I know that this race car is very easy to see out on the racetrack as well. Bob, what's the story behind the color?
Well, Mike, you were really close on the color. It's called Swamp Holly Yellow, and that was the old color. Now they've gone to this brighter color, which, you know what, is actually an orange and not a yellow.
Well, I don't think they'll have to change the name of the company, but you never know.
Probably not.
All right, let's go to a little bigger controversy. The Gene Haas 00, the Net Zero Chevrolet. Jason Leffler has been the driver of this car all season. They stand third in points. Leffler was informed, not officially, but found out from the shop that his seat was being removed from the car and that he would not be driving it here this weekend. Lawyers got involved, injunctions were filed, and even as late as an hour or so ago, it was questionable who would be in this car come qualifying time. And I'm not sure if it's settled that for tomorrow's race, will Blake Feast be in the car, the 22-year-old Hendrick Development driver, or will Jason Leffler return to the seat that he's occupied all season and drive this car in the race?
And what we need to follow up with this, we anticipate that the reason this has happened is because of an announcement that will be made next week about Jason Leffler's future. But I talked to Jason this morning. He said, Larry, I absolutely did nothing to breach my contract. My contract is up at the end of this year, and I was just maybe moving on to bigger and better things for the future.
But he intended to drive the car the balance of the season. He stands third in points, hopefully collect his point fund check at the banquet. And as far as the performance end, like you say, he's held up his end of the bargain. What he plans to do for next year, not sure if that should enter into this or not, but the team obviously feels differently. Blake Feast is in the car. He is in the Hendrick Development Program, and the Haas team is a part of that. So his lap is strong, fifth quickest with a 30.89.
Yeah, he picked up quite a bit on that second lap. I talked to Booty Barker this morning, Jeff, I think you did too. Booty said it would take the better part of a half a day to get Jason's seat and seat mounts and seat belt mounts back in this race car. It would not be something that could happen real quickly. And Marty, I think you're actually with Booty Barker.
Yeah, I was sitting here chatting with him while he was qualifying, so I said, well, let's talk to him about it. Who is going to race the car tomorrow definitively? Do you know?
Yeah, Blake Feast.
Blake Feast will be in the car tomorrow. Did Jason come in the garage area this morning and try to work things out?
It's better if I don't even say nothing, Nate. We love Jason to death. Blake's a great guy. We're just racing, doing what we got to do. We'll let everybody else worry about that stuff.
And obviously a short learning curve for you and Blake, but it seems to have worked very well off the bat.
Yeah, I mean, he hadn't tested here. We brought a new car and unloaded, and he's fast. So he's doing a great job.
And Booty was telling me they should be very good tomorrow in the race. That's actually where they think he'll be the strongest.
And that's the answer Booty Barker should have given. You know what? We're here to race. We can't get caught up in that. The person I feel for is Blake Feast. He's caught in the middle of this whole thing.
Well, both these guys are, Larry. Well, I look at it, you know, there's Booty right there, the crew chief, trying to do his job. You got Blake right now just trying to follow and fill in where he needs to, and Jason Leffler. You know, this is things that should have been settled somewhere else besides the racetrack.
And Larry, I don't feel bad for Blake. Every empty seat is an opportunity for some driver. Somebody's going to fill that seat. He's done a great job, obviously, of stepping in and putting this car up in the top five. Guy I feel for is Jason Leffler,
yes,
who feels like he's done everything he should do to keep this a contending team. He's running in the top three in points, and suddenly he's out of a ride because of something that isn't going to happen until next year. There's more to this story, and I'm sure we'll learn it as the weekend goes on.
I think you're absolutely right, Mike. Casey Atwood, on his second lap, he picks it up to 14th quickest, 31.20. Good lap for Casey.
That'll put him 14th fastest in the U.S. Navy Chevrolet. 35 of 54 drivers have had their turn at the clock so far.
Back at the Kansas Speedway, Paul Menard still the man on the pole. Michael Waltrip getting ready to qualify his State Fair Chevrolet. And you guys finished 11th last week at last time out at Dover. That's not a great achievement, but it seems like you guys have kind of turned a better corner here, Michael.
We have. How do you like my helmet?
Interesting, I would say.
It's the corn dog man on there, and he's squirting mustard all over the place. I'm glad you noticed, Marty. We worked so hard, and we've tested. And Jerry and Joe and all the boys have tried to figure out where we went wrong. We won Nashville, and we've been terrible since then. Actually had Daytona won on the last lap, which would have been huge for our little team out of Sherrill's Ford, but got wiped out. But we've struggled lately, and last year this car was the deal every time it showed up. And we just want to try to get back to that mode. That was a lot more fun. Plus, it cost less. I didn't have to do all this stupid testing. But we have State Fair on board here this weekend. We'll go to Charlotte next weekend with the Aaron's Dream Machine and hopefully get back on track.
And save for a couple laps in this race last year, almost won the thing.
That's pretty funny. I like that helmet. Yeah. Mustard all over.
David Strimmy, he's going to like this qualifying run. And he actually, it felt so good on that first lap. He said, you know what, I don't think I can do any better on this second lap. He shuts her down. But David will be sixth quickest.
But Larry, some of them starting to notice right now, further we go, the slower the times are as far as comparing to this morning. He's about 3/10 off of what he practiced at earlier this morning.
So the trim spot Dodge is sixth, second fastest Dodge to Casey Kane. And the point standing leader will roll out on track, Martin Truex Jr., Bass Pro Shops Tracker Boat Chevy.
This should give us a pretty good indication of what the track is doing and how it is. And Paul Menard will get a really good test here as far as his time, which he's already posted on about a 36-7. Martin can go up there and better that.
Now, why is he shaking that car back and forth on the back stretch?
Trying to get those tires right there worked in, Mike. He's trying to get them shook around and get them build a little bit of pressure and get kind of stable under him so he can really get after it on his first lap.
So with the sun on the track, first lap will be the one if you can get it.
I think so right now. If you can get those tires kind of, you know, happy with the air pressure and getting his grip going, this should be his best lap.
This is such a hit-your-mark, line-sensitive racetrack, especially qualifying. You got to drive it right to the bottom, and the minute that thing feels like it takes a set, you can see him wiggling a little bit right there, you have to pick that throttle up and stay in it. If you don't stay in the throttle all the way off the corner, it kills the straightaway speed right here.
12 front-row starts this season for Truex. Best average start of anybody in the series, but not today. 30.85, fifth fastest.
He has slowed down a half a second for what he practiced, and I think majority of that is in the racetrack.
He's one spot away from Kyle Busch, who trails him by 152 points for the lead.
Just what a season this race team has had, though. 27 starts, 5 wins, 6 poles, 14 top fives, 20 top tens. They have finished on the lead lap in 25 races this year.
Did he pick it up? No, 15 hundredths slower. So Truex is fifth.
I think right now Paul Menard has got to be breathing a little bit of a sigh of relief. And yep. I believe Mr. Dillner has caught up with another young man breathing a sigh of relief.
He is breathing a sigh of relief. Blake Feast we're talking about, but he's been a little bit nervous here. He wanted to stay in the top five, but you just got knocked out. But still pretty darn good for your first run in this race car.
Not bad. I kind of figured the 8-car beat us. He was real good there. But for never working together, you know, the whole team, the whole Haas Automation team, Booty Barker, they unloaded a great car right off the truck. Just a privilege for me to drive. Glad to be here. And hopefully, I really think we have something for him in race trim.
And guys, Blake has been told that he will run the car tomorrow. Definitely, he does not know how many more races he will run for the rest of the year. He's hoping for more. And guys, the crew came down and said, hey, why did you go on the apron on that lap? And he said, well, the guys in the TV booth told me to.
And by the way, Blake and Jason Loeffler are good friends.
Yes.
And they spent a little time together. Blake called Jason, we're told, when this news first came down, and he says, boy, I'm glad I'm going racing. I hate it happens this way. But they remain good friends, and that's good.
And, of course, Blake, like Boston Reid, is one of the Hendrick development drivers, and that 00 car, the Haas car, has an affiliation with Hendrick Motorsports. They actually use the engines from Hendrick's.
Number 80 is Chris Horn out of Cedar Rapids, Iowa, the Seafoam Sales Chevrolet. He has 29 NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series starts. Now, this would be his first Busch Series race.
He's a go or go home, and he was 50th quickest earlier in practice, and right now he is only 35th quickest on his first lap out of the 38 cars that have been on the clock. Let's see if he can pick it up a little bit.
Yeah, he needs a half a second.
He picks it up a little bit, but picks up no position, so that's going to be very borderline for Chris Horn.
Marty.
Mike, Ron Hornaday spent most of the day on top of the speed charts and ninth when practice ended, but the sun's been baking this racetrack for a good 45 minutes now. Is that what's making the time slower, Ron?
I hope not. I mean, Bush and the guys really built an awesome car. We haven't touched it all day, taped it off, and the car is pretty good. So we'll just see. We're going to use that RCR horsepower and try to get this thing on the pole, but hopefully that cloud comes over. I don't know if it's going to help or not.
All right, he's hoping for that money cloud, as they call it. Ninth fastest in practice today for Hornaday.
Another driver whose future is uncertain for 2005.
This here is definitely a new look for Greg Biffle. We're kind of used to seeing him in some different colors, but right now he is sporting the red, white, and blue colors with CNN on the side of his car.
America Votes 2004. Is this a voter registration drive effort?
As you heard Greg saying earlier, he was only 18th quickest in practice.
But there's one thing about Greg Biffle, you know this to be true, Larry. When it comes time to qualify, he has the ability to find some speed.
He has 3 Busch Series starts here, all with top 5 finishes.
First lap's good enough for 12th quickest.
I'm sure he's hoping this car is, you know, fair and balanced.
Yes.
Yeah.
Are you trying to say it's a bipartisan car?
No, it's just an allude to one of our Fox Network partners, that's all.
A 31.06 on his first lap. He only slowed down about a half a tenth from what he ran in practice. He'll slow down another tenth and a half on lap two, so right now Greg will be 12th quickest.
So Biffle is the second fastest Ford to Mike McLaughlin, who is 10th. Biffle is 12th. Paul Menard right now is quickest, and the point leader, this man, is 5th. Kansas Speedway, where Jimmy Kitchens has timed in with the BG Products Ford, 32.508, and that is 37th. Bumping has begun. Bill Eversoll, Clint Vosholtz have been bumped. Steve Grissom did not make a qualifying run. Final practice, happy hour from Kansas. Tomorrow noon Eastern time, right here on Speed.
Well, the exciting thing about it, 7 races to go in the chase for the championship, and every qualifying session and every happy hour show will be on Speed. And while we're talking about television shows, we still want to continue to wish Alan Beswick a quick, speedy recovery from breaking his leg about a week and a half ago. He's at home recovering. Look forward, maybe hoping to see an Alan back at Lowe's Motor Speedway next week in Charlotte.
Tim Fedewa on track in the Supercut Chevy. He will be the 42nd driver to take time. And don't forget, Bud Poole qualifying for Nextel Cup follows right after this.
He times in at 22nd fastest right now to 31.31, and got a chance to talk to his crew a little earlier. Said that both their cars, as far as his teammate Casey Atwood and his car, both felt pretty good, but they just really weren't going anywhere. So we're gonna make a few changes before this qualifying session, see if we can pick them up a little bit. And it looks like maybe they have helped the cars a little bit, at least in my opinion, Larry, because they're very close to what they practice at, and I believe that the weather has slowed the track itself down. So I think they have picked up what they had done earlier.
The Tim slows down a little bit on that second lap, so he will be 22nd quickest that first lap.
Bob?
Well, Martin Truex Jr. got bit by the double S's, Stickers and Son. Martin, just a little bit slower, and I know I can see the expression on your face, a little bit disappointed.
Well, yeah, you know, you always are when you can't back up your practice time or the weather goes like that, but we were just way, way, way too tight. I'm pretty happy with fifth, as bad as it was, so. I'm not sure what got us. Stickers, maybe a little bit of weather, but hopefully my teammate will hold on to it. You know, it'll be his first pole. That'll be really cool. So nevertheless, it's a good starting spot for us, and I really feel good about the race tomorrow. So just work hard and happy hour.
Truex Jr. fastest in practice, but as you boys said, a lot of those times, including his, were on scuffed tires.
Well, here's the series' biggest top dog. It's the state fair
car. Oh, I can't believe you went there.
Michael Waltrip. Well, he is at Kansas. He's been the pole man here the last two trips here, including his track record run last year in qualifying for this race, 30.27. Nobody's within 0.4 of that yet today.
Car looks a little evil from the center out. Almost looks like it has that same front end not turning look that a lot of the cars we've heard the drivers say their cars had. And right now in his first lap, he ends up 11th quickest at a 31.03.
We'll see if the happy hot dog man is on his helmet is still smiling at the end of this run.
I don't think he's going to be. I know how Michael is. He told me in the garage here earlier, his car was evil during practice. It felt good during race runs, but when he put it in qualifying trim, he said it had that slide and kind of a pitch and catch kind of feel to it. And he said, I don't like that. And he said, I've got to do something about it. And I don't think they quite got it where they wanted, even though they made several changes before qualifying.
He was the track record holder here, and I think that track record probably safe for now.
It's pretty safe, I think. Michael Waltrip is 11th right now with 11 cars left to go.
Back at the Kansas Speedway, Paul Menard still dodging all the bullets, still the fastest car in qualifying for the NASCAR Busch Series. Tony Stewart getting ready to go play with the Busch Series guys. You got a busy 10 minutes coming up. The next to last car to qualify in the Busch Series and the first car in the Cup Series. How are you going to get all this done?
Easy. They'll let one go out at a time. So I don't know. I think NASCAR is pretty good about understanding the situations here. So we're just going to stop at the end of where the turn is for the garage and get out of our Bass Pro Shop Chevrolet with Chance too, and do a little. I'm not going to jog because I'm not going to embarrass myself. So I'll just ease down to the old number 20 Home Depot Monte Carlo. So we'll get them both done.
I understand this car was pretty good in all race trim practice this morning.
Yeah, the hard thing is we didn't do any qualifying runs at all, so this will be the first time that I've run the qualifying setup on this car. But, you know, we've got Bono and Martin down there, and Martin was a little tight, so our setups are real similar. I think we put just exactly what he had on, just we'll make some air pressure adjustments and try to make it a little better.
Believe it or not, this is the same exact chassis Dale Earnhardt Jr. won Bristol with a few weeks ago with a brand new body.
Thanks, Marty. Kevin LePage, who was the pole sitter for the first Busch race here at Kansas in 2001, takes his Kaiser Compressors Chevy to a run of 32.17. That is not quick enough for the top 38.
And Mike and Jeff, these guys will have a final practice here later on this afternoon after Nextel Cup qualifying. But watching the weather this morning, it looked a little iffy. So I think a lot of teams, as you heard Tony Stewart talked about, worked on race setup in that two-hour practice this morning.
Yeah, a lot of teams did. They really worked hard on trying to get that balance and everything they needed, because they really were afraid that the weather was going to come back in. They wouldn't get that happy hour, and they wanted to be kind of like ahead of the curve. On the track right now in the 39 car, Tina Gordon, the Yahoo Ford. Got a chance to talk to Tina on the way up to the booth, and she was pretty down on herself right now, because she really feels like, you know, she should be running better than what she is. This is the first time she's had an opportunity here to come to Kansas and really get after this track like she thought she should be able to. But she's been working on the line and trying to get it down, and she was hoping she could pick it up here some qualifying.
10 races, she's still looking for her first top 25 finish and her first top 25 start. She had a big race here last July in the Craftsman Truck Series.
Yeah, of the 54 cars that practiced earlier, she was 53rd on the chart, so Tina's going to really need to pick it up on this qualifying run. First lap, 33.32. That's only about 3/10 quicker than what she practiced.
And that trails the field by about 6/10 of a second. Four cars here, 11 will go home. Right now, the 38th spot is Stan Boyd at a 32.05.
And what I hear with her car is she's just out of the gas so long. I know this morning in practice, the track had a lot more grip than we talked about. I talked to Casey Atwood, and he said down in 1 and 2, he couldn't run it completely wide open qualifying, but he only had to breathe it just for a second, about half throttle.
So 33.32 will be the lap of record for Tina Gordon.
But this is a mile-and-a-half racetrack, and right now Paul Menard's average speed is over 176 miles per hour, which means they're entering the straightaway over 190 miles per hour into these corners.
Every one of these drivers I've talked to so far said this place was bad fast this morning, and I guarantee you, Larry, carrying that kind of speed around here, you have to keep your foot down if you want to be up toward the front as far as the starting field is concerned.
Ron Hornaday, the AC Delco Chevy, who won the Alan Kulwicki Memorial 250 up at Milwaukee State Fair Park back in July, has 3 front row starts this season. And kind of a mixed bag of results here at Texas. In 3 races, he started 35th, 10th, and 9th. He's been told by Richard Childress that somebody else will be in that seat for 2005, so Hornaday is actively seeking a ride. And he says he's a former champion of the Truck Series. He's had some seasons in the Cup. He says of the 3, the Busch cars are the toughest to drive between Nextel Cup, Craftsman Truck, and the Busch Series because of the short wheelbase. Makes them much more difficult to drive than either a truck or a cup car.
Yeah, they're 7 inches shorter than a Craftsman Truck Series, and they're 5 inches shorter than a Nextel Cup car, the shortest of the 3 series. And Ron's first lap is 6th quickest. Remember, we were talking to him a while ago. He was 9th quickest in practice. He has lost about 1/10 and a half from what he ran in practice, and he slows down another 1/10 on that second lap. So right now, Ron will be 6th quickest, another big bullet that Paul Menard had to dodge.
6 of the top 7 so far are Chevrolets. Oh, there's
Fifi.
Is that Fifi? Local driver Randy Briggs, the 2003 NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series second runner-up for Rookie of the Year. Runs a lap at 32.72. That won't make the top 38, and Briggs will head home. 6 cars to go in Busch Series qualifying. Shane Hall ran a lap, let's see here, not quick enough to make the top 38. 41st fastest, 32.37, so his number 28 Ford will head home. This is Johnny Sauter in the Kleenex Chevy, number 27, 10 top 10 starts this year. And he's had an 8th and a 19th place start here at Kansas in 2 appearances. This will be his 100th series race.
You see right there, 26 quickest. They have the front of this car so soft. And as you heard even Matt Kenseth talk earlier about how, and Robbie Gordon talk about how a driver really drives a crawl from the corner qualifying, it's actually bottoming out and smoking the left front tire as he drives off in the corner.
It is, and that's not going to help his effort at all right there, Larry. But talked to some guys that work on that car, but they told me today that they're going to be switching manufacturers next year. They're actually going to be going to Fords and getting away from these Chevrolets and trying to get their act together for next year.
Sauter is 21st.
Wicked, oh, my God.
I feel for him, too, guys.
I see that baby on tape. Get into turn 3. Wicked loose.
It might be because the left front spring was solid.
Up against the left front fender.
Wow. A wild ride for Johnny Sauter, but 21st place.
And you can hear it in his voice for
sure.
Oh,
yeah. That bumps Brad Teague. This is Morgan Shepherd, the oilimages.com American Kart Exchange Chevrolet. Race work also on the 0 for Morgan. Now, the going homers so far will include Horn, Briggs, Voschultz, Boyd, Hall, Teague, and Eversole. Those cars have been bumped out of the top 38 and are too low in provisional points. Derek Cope right now is the bubble car as Morgan makes his run.
He was 40th in practice earlier today, Mike, and if he could run the same time, that would be quick enough to get him into the top 38, but just barely. So it'd be interesting to see how this weather and how everything kind of plays out as far as this lap is concerned. His first lap, he's 32-40, and he's got to pick it up a little bit if he wants to get in the show.
We've been talking about birthdays. Next Tuesday, Morgan Shepherd will be 63 years old.
Years young.
Years young. There you go. Yeah. And with Morgan, that's definitely the case.
15 wins in this series. He was one of the original Busch Series drivers when late model sportsman became the NASCAR Busch Series in 1982. So that's a good question from our production folks. There's a yellow stripe on that bumper. If there's anybody here who's not a rookie, it's Morgan Shepherd. I'm guessing they made a driver change. Didn't make a tape change.
Yeah, probably Curtis so. Davis, I think, was scheduled to be in this car, and he would have been a rookie.
32-40. Both laps for Shepherd nearly identical. That will not make the show, and that car will head home. Tony Stewart driving a team car to Martin Truex, Tracker Boats, Bass Pro Shops, and it says smoke over the window on the driver's side. This will be his third Busch Series race of 2004. He started 6th both times.
I've been seeing smoke above one of the doors on his Nextel Cup car here of late. He was 28th quickest in practice, but as you heard him say in his interview, they did no qualifying runs in practice earlier. Mainly worked on race stuff.
If anybody can go out there and make a qualifying effort in a car with it never been taped up for qualifying, it had to be Tony Stewart, because he has the ability to feel the car out and adapt to whatever it's telling him to do better than I think a lot of guys could ever ask for.
Derek Cope on the hot seat, but he'll have a provisional. The hotter seat belongs to John Hayden.
10th
because,
quickest.
Yep, Tony's run of 10th place just bumped Hayden back to 38th. If he gets bumped out of 38th, he goes home.
And what putting that tape on the nose does, yeah, it reduces the drag and makes it run much faster down the straightaway, but it really pins the nose. You heard Johnny Sauter talk about how loose his car was. That's what it does. It pins the nose. It can make the car loose, so you have to do other chassis adjustments. You see right there, he's taped up solid to compensate for that tape. Slows down on that second lap, but Tony would be pretty happy with that. 10th quickest.
Almost a half a second quicker than what he practiced.
Now, the way the provisional situation lines up, it looks like the going homers are going to be Horn, Briggs, Voschultz, Boyd, and Hall, along with Teague, Shepherd, Eversole, Kitchens, and Steve Grissom would be next up the list, but because he's a past champion, he would use the final provisional, and that means that Gus Wasson would go home. Looks like we have 2 left to go, including Mike Bliss.
So for Hermie Sadler right now, he can breathe a sigh of relief, so
He's in. Eric Jones is in.
Both these cars. Well, we got two cars to go, Mike. So it's going to be real close yet. Right. Eric Jones for sure. Hermie Sadler's in the show tomorrow.
Right. Hayden and Jones are 38th and 37th, and both of them are on the go or go home list. So Mike Bliss, with 10 top 10 starts this season, the 2002 Truck Series champ, will probably bump somebody out of the show right here in his Rockwell Chevy.
Yeah, he was 10th quickest in practice earlier. He was awfully quick.
And even if he has a problem, he's high enough up in the points, he will be assured a starting position for tomorrow. So let's see what Mike does as far as his qualifying.
This is one of the race teams, especially when you talk about Mike Bliss, that rumors continue to somewhat surround for next year. Unknown. Ooh, you see right there, real loose over there when he picked the throttle up coming off turn two. His first lap, though, 30.91. He's eighth quickest.
Crew chief, call him, tell him, get in there.
Stop. That's
you're
good
in the
enough.
Top 10. Let's get it done here.
Yeah, Mike's been informed by this team that they are working on putting together another package with a different driver. So I guess he's free to look, but he's not released for next year. So that's really a kind of a situation of limbo.
And he slows down quite a bit on that second lap, and I think we know why.
Drove through one and two, the first lap real good. The second one I drove, or went down into three and didn't really lift much. And I had to lift on exit because it got real tight off four, and then it got loose into one and two. Oh, well.
Tried to get a little bit more is what he was trying to say. That's and right. It felt so good the first lap.
So that will send John Hayden home. Puts Gus Wasson back in the show. According to our unofficial tally, John Hayden will go home, and the final decision will be this man right here, Kenny Hendrick, who has one Craftsman Truck Series start at Kansas, his first run here in a Busch car in this number 51. And the question mark is going to be Eric Jones, who right now is 38th. If Jones gets bounced out of the top 38, I think that would put Tina Gordon back into the field. Actually, it would just put Steve Grissom to where he's the last time provisional, doesn't need the champions provisional.
And Kenny would have to pick up 2 seconds from what he ran in practice earlier. He was the slowest of all the cars that took practice this morning.
That's exactly what I was looking at, Larry. How much has he got to pick up? Is it a couple tenths? But in his case, he's got to pick up over 2 seconds if he wants to know.
Well, he picked up one of them.
Picked up one of them.
One down,
sure.
One to go. 32.99 for Kenny.
He's actually got to run at least a 31.88.31 if he wants to knock Eric Jones out of the race and put himself in the starting field.
This is one of Rick Ware's Dodges. And the final qualifier completes his run, picks it up another half a second, 32.41, but that won't be enough to make the top 38.
That's a super effort to pick up that much, but it's a shame he's coming up short.
And that will take Hendrick out of the show and put, I believe, Tina Gordon back in. So let's meet the pole sitter.
Yeah, career pole number one for Paul Menard. And how nerve-wracking is it to sit there and watch all those guys who beat you in practice take a shot at you in qualifying and not have them knock you off?
Well, it's definitely nerve-wracking. You know, I have to sit through, you know, 45 cars or whatever it was. But it's pretty cool that we went out early for once. You know, usually going out late helps you. Going out early today helped. The sun came out later on and slowed everybody down for us. But hats off to Tony Gibson, good DEI horsepower. Lots of help from Martin Truex and Bono and all those guys, so it's pretty cool.
Now let's focus on the race. Did you get a lot of race practice this morning?
We did, but it wasn't very good race practice. We were coil binding the left front spring, and we're going to change the bucket, change the spring, and do a little work there and hopefully get some more travel and be pretty fast tomorrow.
So some work ahead for the pole sitter. Race practice coming up for the Busch Series cars, but Cup qualifying coming up right now.
Paul Menard is the 16th different driver to win a Busch Series pole in 2004, the 7th first-time pole winner this season. His previous best was 8th at Talladega.
And just like all year long, there you see them right there together. Our 2 points leader, Kyle Busch, 4th, Martin Truex Jr., and 5th in the 8 car.
And look at row 4 right there, the 00, Blake Fries making his first start here at Kansas. Great effort.
Page 2. Tony Stewart, Kenny Wallace, a couple of Cup veterans there.
A lot of bushwhackers there in that second group.
And another rookie, Brandon Miller, in the top 20.
Wally Dalla back there in row 10, along with Joe Nemechek.
So what do you call you, an announcer that goes runs a Busch race? There's got to be a name for it.
Deranged. I don't know. Come on, he's a race driver first and an announcer
yes,
second.
He is.
Wally
that's right.
is, so
he is.
That's okay. Now, if one of us tried to do that, we would be deranged.
Then that would be deranged.
All right, the final qualifier on time gets the asterisk. That's Eric Jones. Everybody else, that's Provisional Land. Kevin LePage and Derek Cope, along with Wasson, Grissom, and Tina Gordon back in the show because Kenny Hendrick will be one of the 11 who did not make it. And here's a look at that list of those who head home. So a rookie will lead them down to the green flag. Menard, the fastest Chevy. Casey Kane, the fastest Dodge. And 13th place Mike McLaughlin, the fastest Ford for the Mr. Goodsense 300 tomorrow. Enjoy the race, folks. Stay tuned for Butt Pole qualifying for Nextel Cup next.